Central Britain, 200 million years ago. Inland seas, trapped by the buckling of the Earth's crust, gradually evaporate, leaving behind thick deposits of salt, soon buried by centuries of earth, clay, and rock. Rainwater percolates downwards through underground streams, dissolving the crystallized minerals, and reappearing kilometers distant in the form of bubbling natural springs. But no drinking water, this. The liquid that emerged from the springs of Droitwich was the strongest natural salt water known to man.
And it looks like being a busy day today. Droitwich Carnival Parade this morning starts out at 10 o'clock.
A Saturday morning in June, Carnival Day for Droitwich, and the town is keen to show off its bright costumes and colourful makeup in the early morning sunshine. The battle is on for the award of Best Float.
Today will be dry and sunny with a light southwesterly breeze. Today's peak temperature will be 28 degrees Celsius, that's 82 degrees Fahrenheit. Later on, a sunny, very warm evening.
Amidst the cacophony of competing sound systems, the judges consider their decision. Some just can't bear to look. The competition lost and won. The procession sets out on its colourful tour of the town. Local charities this year benefited by well over £900 as a result of the carnival appeals. As the people of Droitwich enjoy the early summer sunshine and the spectacle of the passing parade, quietly observing the proceedings is the local museum and tourist information office, the Droitwich Heritage Centre. Here, among the surrendered possessions of generations past, can be discovered the secret that lies behind, or rather beneath, this unique Worcestershire town. More than 2,000 years ago, prehistoric man was already beginning to process the salt water that bubbled up naturally here from the ground below. Each of these tanks would have contained over 3,000 gallons of brine, enough to make more than 4 tons of salt. And all of it had to be carried by hand. First from the springs to the tank, then to the hearth for boiling, finally packed into pots like these, the hard, dry blocks of salt were distributed throughout Worcestershire and out to Shropshire, Gloucester, and the Cotswolds. The Romans brought in their own style of management. A military fort was built on Dodder Hill, and it appears the salt industry was now to be run from a Roman villa at Bay's Meadow. The ancient saltways were also taken in hand and developed to carry the merchandise even further afield. The Roman road network served Droitwich well during the Anglo-Saxon period, when the area became so active commercially that Edward the Confessor allowed Saltwick, as it was then known, to mint its own coins. The salt trade continued to flourish, and the town grew steadily in economic and political importance. But in the middle of the 13th century, disaster struck. The brine well dried up, and the town was faced with ruin. To the rescue came a figure whom most of the locals hadn't seen for more than 30 years, Richard de la Witch. In the Church of the Sacred Heart, the story of the town's patron saint is told in a series of beautiful mosaics. Richard was born at the end of the 12th century in the old manor house in Droitwich, on the site where the Raven Hotel now stands. As a young man, he worked on the family farm and later studied canon law in Italy. By 1224, he had become Bishop of Chichester, and it was in this role that he returned once again to his old hometown. Accompanied by the desolate townsfolk, Richard visited the dried-up well in Vines Park and then bestowed upon it his blessing. The flow of brine was restored, and Droitwich resumed its position as a major inland salt producer with renewed commercial vigour.
For hard the work and low the pay, we stoke the fires 12 hours a day, and life evaporates away till salt doth lose its savour.
In the middle of the 19th century, the Droitwich salt industry faced a second serious crisis. Just at a time when commercial competition was at its strongest, the local brine was running weaker. Profits fell, factories closed. Once again, Droitwich prayed for help. But this time, salvation lay in the hands of a disciple of a newer order, that of engineering and physics. It was on the sale of the family business that the son of a local narrowboat operator took his half of the firm's profits and steered his attention instead toward the business opportunities offered by underground waterways. As a canal boatman servicing the salt works at Stoke Prior, John Corbett, himself an engineer, had visualized more advanced methods of extracting and processing the brine. Methods which were more efficient and thus more profitable. One by one, Corbett bought up the industry's bankrupt properties, turning each, once again, to productivity. He built a large school, new housing, and a working men's club. He saw himself as a model employer of men, improving their comfort in this life and their prospects for the next. In 13 years, he had turned the whole of the Stoke Prior area from an echoing wilderness of empty, shuttered factories into 30 acres of intense industrial activity. Corbett's business fortunes were far from untroubled. Indeed, it was at a time when the salt industry was especially depressed that he started making new plans for Droitwich. The key, as before, was salt. The treasure house to be unlocked, tourism. Under the sign of the Raven, Corbett set Droitwich on a fresh course. In June 1887, he opened the St. Andrew's Brine Baths, the centerpiece necessary to the town's new role of holiday resort.
And from the ground whence brine did flow, the townsfolk watch a new town grow, and every man in Droitwich owe his fortune to John Corbett.
A new railway station was opened in June 1899. John Corbett provided the land on which it was built. Hundreds of people lined the streets to watch a procession headed by the King's Shropshire Light Infantry make its way along Ombersley Street to another of Corbett's contributions to the town, the Salter's Hall. Built some 18 years earlier, the hall could hold meetings of up to 1,500 people. John Corbett saw, in his Salter's Hall, the embodiment of his paternalistic benevolence. By the 1930s, however, all that the good folk of Droitwich saw were movies. And shortly after this photograph was taken, the hall was demolished to make way for a purpose-built cinema, itself now converted into the town's library. Only the old Jubilee clock now remains, to measure the passage of time. One of Corbett's most lasting memorials is his house at Impney. Initially suggested by his French-educated wife, the chateau, as it's now known, was designed by a French architect, Auguste Tronquoy. No expense was spared. The river Salwarp was diverted and deepened to meander decadently between the artificial lakes of the newly landscaped grounds, which, once a week, were made open to the public. But wealth alone could not guarantee happiness. Industrial relations were becoming unstable. His relations with his wife were worse. Despite many financial gifts made over more than 20 years to religious, social, and political bodies, not to mention a respectable, if undistinguished, career as a member of parliament, no royal honors came his way. Disillusioned with life, public and private, long separated from his wife, and estranged from his children, on the 22nd of April, 1901, the Squire of Impney, the Salt King, died, aged 84 years. If Victorian Droitwich was put on the map thanks to its natural features, it was a very man-made feature which continued its prominence into the 20th century. Responsible for transmitting the BBC's national programme on 1,500 metres long wave, Droitwich soon became a familiar name throughout Britain and in many parts of Europe. The erection of the two 700-foot masts was begun in 1933, and the station was officially opened in September the following year. Since then, the transmitter has increased its power more than threefold, enabling listeners as far afield as Gibraltar to hear some of this country's favourite radio programmes.
Fertiliser, wasn't it?
That's it. Mm. Reminded me to order right away and get me rebate.
And did you?
Of course. Should have been a mug if I didn't.
Some 20 years after it was commissioned, the Witchpole transmitter carried the first episode of a programme that was to share more than just the fresh country airwaves of North Worcestershire.
So you could if you didn't get rid of your best worker.
The Archers, at 4 o'clock on Whit Monday, 1950, emerged from their cosy farmhouse hearths and dusty grain-filled barns to invite a still war-shattered Briton to come in for a cup of tea and a chat. The first 5 episodes of what went on to become the world's longest-running broadcast serial were transmitted as a trial run to listeners only in the Midlands. The audience of 500,000 that heard the first pilot programme had grown by the end of the following year to 6 million. So what made this everyday story of country folk so popular? Godfrey Baisley, the founder of the series, would sum it up in one sentence, because it was real.
Country folk had got to take it and recognise the pattern of their own lives. And of course, if the family were listening, then the farmer himself was going to automatically listen. And although, to begin with, he may have thought this was a bit of kidology, but in the end, he knew that we were talking sense.
The search for authenticity took Baisley and his engineers away from the studios in Birmingham and out into the farmland of neighbouring Worcestershire. Not only countryside sound effects were required, the team also recorded local choirs and meetings of the Women's Institute. The village of Hanbury is very proud that its own parish church of St. Mary has been used on 3 occasions. The nation first heard the villagers masquerading as the congregation of St. Stephen's of Ambridge in a carol concert broadcast in 1951. They were featured a second time at the wedding of the characters George and Helen Fairbrother, and then again in 1955 in a blaze of publicity at the wedding of Grace and Phil Archer. On this occasion, news of the recording had been leaked and coach parties of fans from all over the county turned up and swelled the congregation to over 500.
This was a shock, because all we wanted was the authentic bells and the choir and the atmosphere. But it was all right at the end because, you know, a full church was better than an empty church. But it was a great do.
Very few drivers along the road between Droitwich and Redditch realise that they are passing close to the property which was used for many early photographs of Dan and Doris Archer's farmhouse, Brookfield. Although the original concept was of a black and white building, this red brick, half-timbered farmhouse was occupied by relatives of Godfrey Baseley and was felt to embody the essence of Dan and Doris's home. But the farmhouse was only half the story.
The exterior was right, but the livestock was wrong because we wanted shorthorn cattle, and we had to go to the Hillman's farm just outside Inkborough to get this shots of this very pedigree herd of shorthorn cows.
A focal point shared by both the very real village of Inkborough and the fictional village of Ambridge is the Old Bull. On entering this ancient Worcestershire pub, it's easy to imagine that the characters from the series are indeed regulars here, an impression which a glance at the wall decorations would tend to confirm. For over the years, Inkborough's Old Bull has often been called upon to play the part of the Ambridge local. On the road from Inkborough to Stratford lies Wootton Hall. Built in 1687, by the second Lord Carrington, for generations a Roman Catholic safe house, Wootton was designed in the style of, and possibly by a friend of, famous architect Inigo Jones. Having come into the ownership of the Guinness family, through two world wars, the hall acted as a military hospital and convalescent home, a time when fire destroyed its fine pitched roofs. With its top story safely restored by its present owner, the hall made a unique and hitherto completely unsung contribution to the Archer series when it was chosen to represent Jack Woolley's country house, Grey Gables. Strangely, the hall's connection with the series was never really publicised, and by the time an actor called Arnold Peters took over the role of Jack Woolley, the link between Wootton Hall and Grey Gables had been all but completely forgotten. Although the village of Ambridge and the county of Borsetshire can only ever exist in the minds of listeners to the radio programme, the threads of rural life around Droitwich have been woven so deeply into the fabric of the Archer's world that it's not difficult to imagine that, on a Sunday morning, the bells of Hanbury Church really do ring out over Hollow Tree, Honeysuckle Cottage, Grey Gables and Brookfield. These archers are real enough. From its origins 25 years ago, the Archery Society of Droitwich has now grown to a membership of more than 50, including quite a few first-class archers. And their aim, simply to provide an unusual activity that all the family can enjoy. And when these kids are out for the afternoon, let no one stand in their way. Here is one Droitwich sport which has not attracted any lady participants. Begun in 1977, the amateur boxing club boasts among its numbers the national schoolboy champion, along with several Midlands title holders and national semi-finalists. Through every flick and twist of their bodies, these butterflies of the boxing ring display a single-minded dedication to their sport from the very first round. So too the members of the Droitwich Golf and Country Club, though they have to walk. The sports complex at Briar Mill has facilities for pursuits both outdoor and in. But for one of the most quintessentially English of all sports, there's no beating a classic village green. Although the Droitwich Cricket Club had been established almost 50 years before it finally made its home in this idyllic spot in the shadow of St. Peter's Church. Club historians proudly point back to the 1930s, when England and Worcestershire cricketer the Nabob of Petordi, friend of the mayor and honorary member of the club, strode out of the crease and scored a century for Droitwich. Not all the bowlers in Droitwich play for the cricket team. The town boasts two bowling clubs. One in Vines Park, and one in the Lido Park. Close to the tennis courts. Of course, you don't have to be a sportsman to work up a sweat or an appetite. John Corbett's elegant Lido Park, laid out for the benefit of his wealthy Victorian hotel clients, is enjoyed today as much by residents as visitors. And once a year, the park fills with colourful stalls and sideshows for one of the traditional highlights of the town's calendar, the Donkey Derby. Organised by the Round Table, this sportive jamboree always attracts record crowds. In fact, so many people turned up for this one that the club ran out of programmes and collected more than £3,000 for charity. At last, the jockeys are prepared, their steeds primed and almost in place, and the enthusiastic crowd are poised for a contest that relates not so much to the sport of kings as to a rugby scrummage. It was actually a horse that the residents of the Coventry Almshouses have to thank for the building of their present accommodation in the Holloway. Legend has it that in 1677, the Honourable Henry Coventry laid a bet with Sir John Packington on a race run on Packington's estate westward. The loser was to endow a Droitwich charity in the name of the winner. Who actually won the race is not officially recorded, but it was Coventry who, one way or another, provided the funds for the almshouses which bear his name. The horse itself now looks down over the home's 60 or so residents from the wall of the community room. For those who ride strictly for pleasure, the countryside around Droitwich provides the perfect backdrop. Mile upon mile of unspoiled rural tranquility, punctuated by magnificent examples from every period of architecture. Home of the Packington family for many generations, now converted into privately owned flats, Westwood House. Hartlebury Castle, dating originally from the 15th century, now housing the fascinating Hereford and Worcester County Museum. Salwarp Village Church, with some 900 years of history in store for the visitor. The church's many memorials to the Talbot family, despite the intervention of the Droitwich Canal, preserve the family's link with their former home, Salwarp Court. Now privately owned, the court is said to be the birthplace of Richard, Earl of Warwick, the kingmaker. Thanks to the Droitwich Canal Trust, the 18th century waterway itself is still largely navigable, but the working vessels for which the canal was originally built, for the export of salt from the town centre, have now given way to leisure craft of all sizes. Dominated by the Saxon-built Church of St. Augustine, Vines Park is the boating enthusiasts' regular meeting place. Here, they even hold a model regatta every year. It was the search for freedom of worship that caused a famous 16th century son of Droitwich to take to the water. Baptized in St. Peter's Church, Edward Winslow was born in the year 1595. After working for a while in the Droitwich salt industry, he soon left the area to become a printer in London. In 1617, a combination of printing and Puritanism drew him to the Pilgrim Press in Holland. But three persecuted years later, he and his wife boarded a small ship, the Speedwell, and returned to England, where they joined up with another 100 pilgrims aboard the Mayflower, bound for America and religious freedom. After a couple of stormy months at sea, the company landed in what is now Massachusetts and founded the colony of New Plymouth. The next 35 years of Winslow's colonial life saw both the humiliation of his rather unfair imprisonment and the honor of his subsequent elevation to Chief Civil Commissioner under Oliver Cromwell, upon whose behalf Winslow set sail on a parliamentary mission to the West Indies. He never returned. Blackwater fever claimed his life, and to a 42-gun salute on the 8th of May, 1655, Edward Winslow, later Droitwich, and three times governor of the colony of New Plymouth, Massachusetts, was buried at sea, somewhere between the islands of Hispaniola and Jamaica. Edward Winslow's voyage on the Mayflower is commemorated in this modern mosaic, a space it shares with other moments from the history of Droitwich. King Ethelbald giving away the rights to a Droitwich salt pit, King John who restored them, and St. Richard, whose look of disbelief at the changes that have been wrought in the town since he saw it last, might be forgiven. For this is the St. Andrew's Square shopping precinct. Here can be found the shops and stores familiar to a modern shopping centre. The shopping precinct takes its name from the medieval market square at the top of the High Street. In the 19th century, the owners of these timber frame buildings each displayed a medallion like these to show the insurance company's fire brigade that they had indeed purchased their protection. No medallion, no rescue. Only one now remains in the High Street, almost unrecognizable under its thick mantle of paint. This High Street fire, however, is most welcome. In fact, Welcome Home specializes in installing domestic fires. If the occupants of the High Street had had Welcome Home's expertise available in the 19th century, they might have worried less about fire and more about the very real threat of subsidence.